With the amount of like fully functional development boards out there, like Arduinos, Raspberry Pis, BeagleBones, things like that, you don't need to use breadboards nearly as often as you used to. However, if you're going to do a whole lot of electronics or basically any custom hardware, you're going to need to use them. So we're going to go over them really quick. They're pretty simple, but we're going to try and take that learning curve from not very steep to absolutely zero. So I have here a couple of examples of breadboards that I have laying around. And basically, they're just the different sizes. We have this really tiny one, the half size, the full size, and then the full size on basically a different platform. So you'll see all of them share some things in common. And one of them is that they're separated into rows, which go this way, and columns, which go this way. So the way that the rows and the columns work is that the rows are electrically connected, whereas the columns are not. So on this particular one, and you can see it actually with all these other ones as well, A, B, C, D, and E in row 1 are all connected together. And then F, G, H, I, and J are all connected in row 1. But anything in row 1 down to row 30 on this is not connected in any way. And so you can use this to basically connect the things that you want to and not connect the things that you don't want to. One important thing as you're doing this is to note that all of these are separated by exactly a tenth of an inch, so 0.1 inch pitch. And that's really helpful when you are using DIP packages, you're getting complicated ICs, things like that. Those DIP packages are designed specifically so you can just plop these in here. I always recommend a socket with that, but that is why they're designed that way, is to fit into breadboards so you can test them out easily. Also, while looking at this, since it's numbered and lettered across this, you can literally say exactly which hole you're going to plug things into. So I could say I want to plug into 15C. And some people, when they're getting into really complicated circuits, they are going to need that sort of precision. Also, if you are following something and you're new, that's a good way to make sure you don't screw things up as you go exactly where they tell you to. But once you get more comfortable with it, you can take some liberties in exactly where is most convenient for you. Another thing to note that is only on these and not on the smallest one is there are these strips on the side. You get the plus and the minus, plus, minus. Now these are buses. So all of these plus right there are connected, all of these minus there are connected. So the reason this is fantastic is if you have 5 volts, you just power supply in, plug it in there, and now that entire line is 5 volts. So if you have different ICs with the same voltage needed, you can just pull off of that, and obviously everything needs to be grounded, so you can ground the blue line, the negative line, and then you can pull that and ground your ICs or whatever else you need to. So that's very helpful. One important thing to remember though is on the bigger one, these are actually split. So right here in the middle, you'll notice there's a break in that line, the blue and the red. So all of these are connected, and all of these are connected, but this is not connected to that. And the first time I realized that was very frustrating because I could not figure out why I wasn't getting power. Now, a simple way to do this is just get a quick jumper, unless you need separate power rails, and you just plug it in, and voila, now those are connected. But if you need 5 volts for one thing and 3.3 volts for another thing, you can put your 5 volts over here and your 3.3 volts over there, and it's a great way to get those separate voltage rails. Other than that though, I can't think of a time when you'd need that, so it's mostly just annoying for me. So another thing you'll notice on these is you have a couple of spots right here, and if you look closely, you can actually tell that they are suited specifically for banana plugs. And so this is to be able to bring power from your power supply without any problems. You just go and plug it in, and that way you're not dealing with these hooks right here and like trying to get connections on here and plugging it in. It just simplifies your life a little bit because you plug in like that, and then using a wire, not necessarily this, you can stick this in here, tighten it up, and then put the power exactly where you want to put it. So that's something, I use that feature on occasion. It's actually not too difficult for me to use the hook, but if you want to move from one place to another and use different power supplies easily, that's one benefit. So that is why those are there. So that's the basic way that the breadboards are set up and how you use them. There are a couple of common pitfalls that I want to recommend that you pay attention to and make sure that they don't happen to you. One of the biggest ones is having things touch that aren't supposed to touch. So I have these two resistors and they're all bent up. And when you put them in, a lot of that metal is still exposed. So you want to make sure that you don't put one in to a spot and then put the other one in and then have them touching in areas that they aren't supposed to be. So I'm just going to use this as a terrible example. So I'm putting this above it and these are really bent. And then having it touch like that. So I'm not sure how easily you can see that, but even though these aren't supposed to be connected, since they're touching right there, they are electrically connected and you're going to have problems. So this is very common, and that actually is something that can be reduced by another common pitfall, and one that I personally struggle with a lot, and that is keep your breadboard clean. As you can see, with these long leads and they get all bent and you want to reuse the resistors if you're a cheapskate like me, then you start to have problems. But when you approach your breadboard, do it with a plan in mind. Try and keep your wires and your leads as trimmed as possible and try and make it have an organized outline. Not only will it make it less likely that you touch things that you aren't supposed to be touching, it'll also make it so you leave the project for 2 to 3 weeks, 2 to 3 months, you come back and you actually know what's going on, because you'll think, oh, I know what I'm doing there, but you probably won't. So try and keep it as clean as possible so it's more understandable and less likely to cause problems. And you'll also notice when things aren't connected that should be connected and vice versa. One other thing, as you probably just noticed as I was dealing with this, I was struggling to push these in. With some of these leads and some new breadboards, it can be kind of tough to get the lead in. So make sure the lead's actually in instead of just, okay, that's it. That's not electrically connected and it will cause problems. So every time you put something in, just make sure you can visually see it go in, which is hard because it's just a single piece of silver and you can't tell very well. But you can kind of get the feel. If you're paying attention, you're good to go. So that's one thing to watch out for. And the final thing that I would say with these to watch out for is making sure you don't accidentally connect things to power and to ground. Again, you have these rails here. And if you think, okay, I'm plugging this into power, and you aren't paying attention, and you plugged it into ground, at best, it just won't work. At worst, something's going to be short-circuited, and you're going to have serious problems. So just pay attention, be precise, be careful. Sometimes I get in a rush, and that's why my breadboards are always messier than they should be. So do as I say, not as I do. Calm it down, be precise, pay attention to what you're doing, and it'll definitely pay off in the long run. As it is, I hope that you learned something. I hope you enjoyed this. If you have any questions or comments, just put it in below. And if you like this video, please subscribe to our channel.